Good morning, everyone. I'm going to try that again. That didn't sound very Nebraska to me. Good morning, everyone. Now that's Nebraska. Welcome to the Nebraska Early Childhood Commission report launch. This is an exciting day for the commission, and it's an exciting day for Nebraska. I am Marjorie Kostelnik. I'm the former dean of the College of Education and Human Sciences at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln and a co-chair of the commission that you are going to be hearing from. In front of me is my fellow commission co-chair, Dr. Sam Mizels, executive director of the Buffett Early Childhood Institute at the University of Nebraska. The Nebraska Early Childhood Workforce Commission is a group of more than 40 public and private sector leaders. It was created 3 years ago to develop a comprehensive plan for strengthening and expanding the state's early childhood workforce. The commission's goal has been to ensure that a skilled, informed, and diverse workforce is available to meet the needs of all Nebraska children from birth to age 8. We're excited that following 3 years of hard work and productive deliberations, the commission is ready to share its findings, its vision, and recommendations with you and with all of Nebraska's residents and decision makers. The focus of the report is on how to tackle one of the most complex and pressing challenges facing Nebraska today. That is, how to expand and strengthen the state's early childhood workforce to meet child and family needs throughout the first 8 years of life. Our report is entitled, it's got a long name here, but it means a lot, Elevating Nebraska's Early Childhood Workforce, Report and Recommendations of the Nebraska Early Childhood Workforce Commission. Every word has important meaning there. Allow me to put the report into a little context. When I first entered the field of early childhood more than 40 years ago, we did not know all that we know today about the importance of the early years on children's development and learning. Many people thought of the really early years as a period that was kind of benign. Children were sort of in an anteroom, waiting to turn 5 or 6 and for the real learning to begin. We had many theories at that time that hinted at the plasticity of the young child's mind, but we didn't have any real visible neurobiological proof. That is until 1997. That's when Newsweek magazine printed the first brain scan photographs of differences in young children's brain development based on what happened in the earliest years of life. Now we could actually see inside the skull of young children. We could see the more developed brain that resulted from positive stimulation, stimulation such as language, movement, interaction with objects, as well as close, secure relationships with caregivers. The negative influences when such things were lacking in children's lives were evident too. We could see for ourselves less brain mass, and in some severe cases, actual gaps in the frontal lobes of very young children's brains. That started a rush to figure out what kind of environments were best suited to promoting childhood learning. In time, we could demonstrate that warm, consistent relationships with a few close adults were key, absolutely key, to child development. Similarly, children's brain development thrived when children were given opportunities to move their bodies, explore the world around them, and be appropriately challenged, talk with peers and adults, and play and interact with print. Over the years, There were some people who assumed that it was the role of families alone to provide such experiences directly. However, the reality is that today, more than 75% of Nebraska's children under the age of 6 have all of their parents working, meaning that these families are relying on the early childhood workforce to support them in promoting children's brain development and learning. Thus, the early childhood workforce makes significant contributions to children's development, and increasingly, they influence the abilities of communities to attract and keep young children in their geographic areas. In spite of its important role, frankly, the early childhood workforce is in trouble. Its members are stressed by low wages, long hours, lack, in many cases, of formal benefits, and often long, long working hours, and sometimes poor working conditions. Many, many love what they do, but they can't afford to keep doing it. Moreover, young family wage earners can't afford to pay the full cost of the high-quality programs all young children deserve. I find myself in an ironic place being in higher education because it costs some families the same to send their infant or toddler to a childcare program as it costs to send a student to a first year in higher ed. And we know that families at both ends of those continuums are stretched way beyond their capacity to be able to do that. Communities count on their employees having access to high quality care and education for children wherever they may be in our 93 counties. Now that you have an initial sense of the scope of this report, allow me to address the members of the commission who dedicated 3 years of their lives to this effort. These individuals came together regularly, they traveled long distances and made time for the work of the commission while continuing to carry out many professional responsibilities. For your dedication, time, wisdom, willingness to take on tough issues, and your collaborative spirit, thank you. At this time, I'd like to ask the commission members to please stand and be recognized. To everyone else in the audience, thank you for being here too, in person and through our live stream connections. More than 500 people are here in the room and also online in 12 different Nebraska communities across the state, including Chadron, Fairbury, Gothenburg, Grand Island, La Vista, Lincoln, McCook, Norfolk, Ogallala, and 3 in Omaha. But that's not all. Yay, let's give them a hand. But that's not all. We also welcome our colleagues from across the country. We have viewers in 14 different states finding out what Nebraska's doing. No matter where you are, please share your thoughts about today's event on social media by using the hashtag EarlyYearsMatter. Most importantly, we would like to recognize and thank the many members of Nebraska's early childhood workforce who work on behalf of young children and their families every day. Hundreds took the time to share their thoughts, beliefs, needs and strategies for supporting children, families, employers, and the workforce itself. They did this through surveys, conversations, community gatherings, and workshops. I'd like to ask everyone to give a round of applause to these early childhood professionals who are making a positive difference in the lives of so many people every day. We are grateful to each and every one of you for the role you are playing in the early childhood workforce. That workforce is key to promoting healthy child development and learning as well as helping to keep Nebraska's economy going strong. As family members go to work and as communities increase their abilities to attract young families to stay or move to Nebraska. For everyone who is in the audience, you will see that there are thank you cards on your table. These are lovely, but they actually have an important purpose beyond being pretty. Please take some of them with you to thank a member of the early childhood workforce who is in your life, either directly with your children, your grandchildren, or someone in your community who is supporting your community. Hand them to that person. Write a little note in the back. Hand it to the person or find a stamp, write it, the note, drop it in the mail, and make someone's day. One more group I would like to recognize. Are there any elected officials today with us who are here? If so, please stand and be recognized. Elected officials, we know you are out there. Thank you. Thank you so much. The Early Childhood Workforce Commission spent 3 years looking at who makes up the early childhood workforce, what their impact is, and what they need from us. We look deeply at the people and organizations that rely on the early childhood workforce, both directly and indirectly. We learned many things, but one thing rose above all. This workforce, and therefore this report, is crucial to the well-being of everyone in our state. The need for a strong early childhood workforce affects us all. We are all part of this endeavor. We are all in this together. To tell you more, it is now my privilege to introduce Senator John Stinner, a member of the commission. In January 2015, Senator Stinner began his first term in the Nebraska State Legislature, representing District 48. He is currently serving his fourth year as chairman of the Appropriation Committee. Please welcome Senator Stinner.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for being here. I think this really sends a message, certainly to me as a legislator, but to the entire state of Nebraska. This is an important subject, and thank you for being here. This has been a long trek for me. It really kind of stretches back to my days at the Gehring School Board. At that time, No Child Left Behind came in, and we started testing our students and finding out if they were really getting what they were supposed to get. And at that time, our third graders, less than 60% of our third graders were reading at the third grade level. And so we continued to test and continued to look, and we thought as a school board, there's nothing more basic than having reading skills, comprehension skills to the learning process to become successful students. But I, as a business person, said not only is a successful student, but successful in life, successful in the workforce, and ultimately, hopefully, a lifelong learner. So we set about not only collecting the data and defining a problem, we set about allocating resources. And I will tell you that we caught flack from teachers, we got flack from parents, we caught flack 2 to 3 years later, 90%, 95% of our third graders were reading at the third grade level. That was amazing, but what it taught me was, first of all, collect the data, define the problem, commit the resources, and then stay focused. And that's really kind of a theme of this whole process that we're going through. We're trying to define a problem. We're trying to figure out what the level of resources that we need to execute on and then stay focused on it. I can tell you that when I started to run for the legislature, I bumped into Superintendent Miles at Scotts Bluff, and he indicated to me that 61% of the kids that they tested weren't ready to be there, weren't ready to learn. And so they joined in a pilot project called Sixpence Project, and I think a lot of you as educators understand 0 to 3. My version of it is teaching parents how to be parents. I can tell you I spent time with those folks. It's impressive. Very impressive. And then when I joined the legislature, you get bombarded with all of the information and challenges. But one of the areas that we looked at, prison overcrowding. We still have an overcrowding problem. We lead the nation right now in prison overcrowding. We're trying to figure out just what our strategy should be to lower that. Obviously, we've allocated some money for a maximum security prison. That will help somewhat. But interestingly, the report I was looking at said of the violent criminal population, 70% were high school dropouts. Think about that. Think about the linkage. Think about the fact when we start to allocate money within appropriations, over $200 million goes to special education. Think about that 60% of the kids showing up not ready to learn. Do they end up as special ed kids to help them with their reading skills, to help them with their vocabulary? Is there something we can do to lower that cap, that number? Those are challenges, those are linkages. That's why I'm interested in early childhood and early childhood development. I think that there also is something to be said when a child is ready for school, they're not going to end up as a dropout, that it improves the quality of our workforce. I think we can bring the business community into this, and after they understand what has gone on and what is the benefit, they will be ready participants. And I'll try to send that message to the business community. The other part of it was, is I was so interested, I went and became an early childhood fellow. I learned about pathways. I learned about brain science, stuff I never have thought about as a banker or a CPA. But it's fascinating. And if we can get that word out to those parents that are sitting there trying to raise their kids, that, you know, the kids don't come with an instruction booklet. But if we can develop that curriculum, if we can tell those people that quality care early on is important. And then we have to deal with the demographics that are in your report. We lead the nation with two parents. The good news is two parents are working because we have a work ethic. The bad news is two parents are working. So single parents, that whole demographic has shifted. So now we have to get the Department of Education to try to endorse some of these ideas and put that into the funding mix. We do provide some grant programs at the state level for early childhood. I think that can be expanded. I also put together a legislative review. We started in Lincoln, went to Kearney, and ended up in Scotts Bluff. What I wanted to do at that particular point in time was to assess, is there an interest in early childhood? What are the challenges that sit out there, and can we address those challenges legislatively, monetarily? So I tried to take kind of an inventory. Lots of people showed up, lots of interest. I think we did a survey that shows across the state, early childhood development is a big area of interest for the entire population. So there's interest, there's data to support it, and now we have to do something. And that's really what this study is about. The reason I joined the commission 3 years ago is because that's the next logical step. And the only part I really played in this was after we did all of this stuff and understanding the diversity across our state, and that's what the LR also gave me, was how diverse it is, how it's delivered. We got to put numbers to it. We got to set a goal. We've got the data. It's a matter now of resource allocation and how do we effectively do that, and then stay focused, execute. So that's my mission today, is to convey that message certainly to you. I will continue to convey it to the business community, to the legislature. We're going to try to put together some kind of LR or a committee to, again, try to assess and see if we can move the ball forward. But this report moves the ball a long way forward in terms of its comprehensiveness, its depth, and it really gives you some targets. And with that, I thank you all for being here. It does send a positive message. I will convey that to my fellow senators when I get back. And I do have to leave after this. I've got an executive meeting that I've got to attend. I apologize. I intended on staying for the whole thing because the area is fascinating. I, as a grandparent, I, as a parent, and you all as parents, this is an area that I think we need to stay focused on. And I think that with the leadership we have on this side of things, with Dr. Mizell and the whole group that has put together, I think we can execute something significant in the state of Nebraska. So thank you.
Isn't it great when the appropriations chair talks about money? Thank you, Senator Stinner, both for your time on the commission and your remarks today. I would now like to introduce Dr. Susan Sarver, the Director of Workforce Planning and Development at the Buffett Early Childhood Institute. She will provide an overview of the report. Susan, welcome.
Thank you very much, Marjorie. Thank you, Senator Stinner. What an act to follow, wow. I'm so happy to be here today on behalf of the commission, and I'm gonna share with you an overview of the report and its goals and what the commission has been doing for the past 3 years. And I wanna extend my own thanks to the commission members. It has been a privilege to work with all of you over the past 3 years. I have learned so much. You have challenged me to think in so many different ways. And I look forward to working with you and everyone else as we move forward, as the senator said, to get this done. I also wanna thank my team, Kathy Huddleston Casas and Kama Charlet. They've been doing this with me from the beginning, and I couldn't have done it without them. So thank you guys. And most importantly, I want to thank all the early childhood professionals out there. They have answered our questions. They challenged us to make real their everyday lived experiences. And they told us we need to make Nebraska the best state in the nation to be a baby. We need to do this and make life better for children and families. Marjorie said it so well. The single most important building block of brain architecture and childhood development is reliable, positive, consistent interactions between the developing infant and familiar caring adults. Think about that. Think about what Marjorie said about those brains and the gaps in the brains. From the moment of birth, families are taking on this responsibility to provide those reliable, positive, consistent interactions. But families work. Parents and guardians have to find other caring, familiar adults to build those relationships, to have those interactions, to continue that brain building that's still going on even while they're working. These familiar, caring adults are the Nebraska early childhood workforce. They are the cornerstone of high quality education. The Nebraska Early Childhood Workforce Commission was convened to strengthen the state's early childhood workforce and to address the challenges for families and communities in Nebraska. In response to these challenges, the commission developed a vision that would elevate the early childhood workforce to a priority profession benefiting all children from birth through grade 3. So what is this priority profession? It's one whose work is essential to the social and economic well-being of the state. Marjorie and Senator Stinner already addressed this, and I'm gonna give you a few more facts to back that up. To accomplish this vision, the commission's developed four goals and associated recommendations. I'm gonna briefly share those four goals with you, and the panel's gonna expand on them and tell you a little bit more about what's in them. Right. So to achieve this vision, here's the four goals. First, we need an early childhood workforce that's highly qualified and that reflects the diversity of the children and families that it serves across the state. We need to fully fund the early care and education system, and we should do this by 2030 is the goal we've set. We must inform, engage, and seek commitment from all Nebraskans. And finally, the commission was really clear. The implementation's going to require collaboration, coordination, and communication across all sectors, engaging with communities across our state. These goals are designed to address some critical needs in our state, the needs of access, quality, affordability, and perception. I'm going to use the words of early childhood professionals from across the state to illustrate the current realities that they face and that our families face. And then I want to share with you the future that the Commission envisions when we fulfill these four goals. All the quotes I'm sharing are from Nebraska educators, and all of the pictures on these slides are also from Nebraska educators, but the words don't always match the slide. They're two different sets. We know that Nebraskans depend on early childhood professionals. These professionals have a really close connection with their families. As one professional said, "I am usually the first to know when a woman in my town is pregnant because she has to get on the waiting list. I usually know before the grandparents and sometimes even before the fathers." These professionals are not only the cornerstone of high quality, they're the foundation for families and communities. This quote shows Nebraskans depend on these professionals. But you heard the senator say, and Marjorie say, 75% of children under age 6 live in a home where all parents are working. And many of these families can't find the care they need. Statewide, 4,000 Nebraskan parents were forced to leave a job, not accept a job, or change a job because of childcare problems. The commission envisions a future where every Nebraska family has access to high-quality early care and education, no matter where the family lives or their income. A future where families have confidence that every setting has a caring, reliable, consistent adult. These adults have specialized knowledge that they bring to work with them every day. Listen to the words of this one early childhood professional. "Early learning people are specialists, and if other people could understand that all of these interactions you have are deliberate and intentional and purpose-driven, I just think they'd understand that that's the magic of preschool, kindergarten teachers, child care providers." Teaching young children requires specialized skills, but the qualifications for early childhood professionals vary dramatically across settings. They depend more on the setting in which a child receives care and education than on the developmental needs of the child. We have so many excellent educators across our state, but the regulations and structures don't recognize their expertise unless they have a degree. And even then, the degree can range from a high school diploma to a master's degree, depending on the setting and the funding source. Some of our least stringent requirements are settings that serve our state's youngest children, our infants and toddlers. Educating and caring for an infant is just as complicated as caring for a third grader. It just requires a different set of skills. The commission envisions a future where qualifications are based on the developmental needs of children and consistent across the settings. For the family looking for the best option for the child, these specialized skills and knowledge should be a given, not a guess. When a family has options to choose from, those choices should be based on their personal preferences, like a preference for an in-home environment or a preference for a program with religious affiliation. Choices made with confidence in the early childhood professional in that setting. Fulfilling goal one will give Nebraska a highly qualified workforce across all settings. Yet having knowledge and skilled educators is not enough to ensure high quality across all settings. Our educators need more support for them to be able to implement the expertise that they bring. In particular, they need adequate compensation and benefits. If you're worried about paying your bills, or if you can't afford your medication, it's really hard to provide those calm, consistent interactions that you need every day with those children. One early childhood professional makes it really clear how difficult this can be. "We have stringent poverty guidelines for Head Start. There's pride swallowing when I think about the fact that I could qualify to have a child in the program I work in. I am the teacher in my program, yet I qualify as a parent." This next educator shares with us the difficulties of being a small business owner of a home-based childcare. I just had major surgery, and the doctor suggested I take 6 weeks off. Well, I have an in-home childcare. There's no way I could take 6 weeks off, so I only took 2 weeks off without pay. Between my health insurance and my mental bills, so far I owe $10,000 out of pocket. Currently, wages and benefits of early childhood professionals vary by the setting where children receive care and education. An educator with a bachelor's degree who teaches in a public school setting in a kindergarten is going to earn an average of $37,000. That same professional, if they went to a community-based childcare, would earn $15,000 less per year. The same professional. The setting matters, and it matters a lot. But what children need does not change depending on their setting. They need caring, qualified teachers. They all need teachers who can afford to show up for them every day and give them the very best. But the stress created by dealing with poverty-level wages and lack of benefits can have an impact on the quality of care that the children receive. The Commission envisions a future where wages and benefits reflect the professional expertise of the early childhood workforce. Improving wages and benefits is a critical component to support our early childhood workforce. We must recognize their professional expertise and compensate them appropriately, no matter the setting they're in. So when we start talking about increasing wages and benefits for all the early childhood professionals, you start thinking, what's it gonna cost? Families, businesses, state agencies, state senators, they start thinking about affordability. How can parents afford to pay more? They're paying the cost of college. How do businesses cope with increased salaries? How do schools provide the services that their families expect and not increase your property taxes? These are all important questions. And so therefore, the Commission's second goal is to fully fund the system by 2030. In the full report, you'll find a detailed discussion of what that full system includes and how much it will cost. But we really need to reframe how we talk about affordability. That's not the right question. Money spent on early care and education is an investment. We should not be asking how much do we spend for this expense. We need to say what is our investment and what is our return. But unfortunately, we're not investing enough. This early childhood professional says it clearly. I have three boys, and one of them wants to be a teacher, and I'm not recommending it. I do not want him to go into teaching. It's not a viable living, and I'm not planning on subsidizing his income. Our lack of investment and our lack of recognition of the importance of this field means we're losing some of the most talented, most capable potential teachers. They don't enter the field or they leave the field. In some settings, there's a turnover rate as high as 26%. We do know that Nebraska is investing. In 2016, an estimated $460 million was spent on early care and education. Over half of that was directly from families. But we still do not have the level of sustained investment that we need to reap the benefits of this high-quality early care and education. There's a gap. The Commission report details the gap and the estimates needed to fully fund the system. The Commission envisions a future where the total cost is funded by combining public and private investments that ensure every child in Nebraska has access to high-quality early care and education, regardless of the setting that their parents choose. This full funding of high-quality early care and education requires only 0.75% of Nebraska's GDP. 0.75%. This funding would include adequately funded early childhood workforce. It would provide high quality for all children and allow affordable access for families. Closing this gap doesn't mean all new money into the system. Within our current system, there are opportunities to increase efficiencies. Let's not forget that many of our providers are small business owners. And in order to have a successful business model, they need stable enrollment and stable revenue. But for many of them, this is a struggle. Coordination within the system is needed. This is a quote from one small business owner. What we get reimbursed for subsidy doesn't even come close. You can't get paid if the child's not there. It affects their enrollment. These small businesses are very adept at meeting their challenges, but currently programs must apply for and combine funding from multiple sources in order to cover their operating cost. Financing coordination is needed. In Nebraska, federal and state funds are distributed through 15 different financing mechanisms with different rules. Rules that can facilitate high quality, help programs do high quality care, or they can be a barrier, taking time and energy away from the children and the families. The Commission envisions a future where the public sector investments are put to their best use. By increasing coordination among agencies, linking the receipts of funding to high quality standards, the state has an opportunity to ensure that every dollar devoted to early care and education is not a dollar spent, but a dollar invested. So what are we going to do about these challenges? It's easy to talk about these barriers. It's easy to envision this future where all of them are gone. But the Commission's determined that we don't just talk. And we don't talk and talk and talk and talk. Yeah, I'm going to wrap up here soon. Okay. But from the beginning, Commission members were adamant that this report should provide a roadmap on how to accomplish long-term sustainable change. So the third goal is based on public will and commitment. Public will and commitment is required for that sustainable change. Survey research shows us that 68% of Nebraskans express support for early care and education. But there's still many Nebraskans who do not understand the complexity of the issues. This early childhood teacher says it best. I don't know so much that society on the outside doesn't value what we do as they truly, honestly don't understand all the moving parts. The Commission envisions a future in which sustained support for Nebraska's early childhood workforce exists in communities across the state. Today is not just the release of a report, it is a launch into action. The 500 people listening today are taking that first step. And now we all need to get to work. The fourth goal is a call to action. We must all work together on behalf of children and families. Nebraskans don't shy away from a challenge, and this is a very worthy challenge. This is the wisdom of an early childhood Nebraska educator. The thing I feel very strongly is that we have all the research that tells us how to care for our kids, yet we are not doing that. Our policies do not reflect what is best for our kids. The science is clear. We do know what is best. We can get to work to achieve the best for children and families in our states. Elevating Nebraska's early childhood workforce to a priority profession requires us to depart from our business as usual, to shift from old mindsets. It requires us to envision a Nebraska where all children have access to high quality early care and education, no matter the settings that their parents choose for them. The Commission is asking you to join with us because all of this is within our reach. Please join with us as we elevate the Nebraska early childhood workforce. Thank you. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Samuel Mizells, the founding executive director of the Buffett Institute. And he's going to lead and moderate a panel of five of our wonderful commission members to delve into a little bit some of these goals and recommendations and what this means for them and what it means for our state. Sam and commission members, if you'd come up, please.
Good morning, and Thank you, Susan. That was a wonderful presentation. And while my colleagues are finding their places here, I just want to say a few words that are off script. I want to thank all of you for being here. I want to thank Susan Fritz for being here. Susan is the former interim president of the University of Nebraska system and the provost and senior executive officer of the university. And it's a great pleasure always to work with her. John Stinner has been an amazing source of knowledge for us. John said to us about a year ago, I need to know the number. I need to know how much money is going into early care and education in this state and how much we need to do this in a quality way. What's the gap? And that's what you will see in the report. I want to thank Matt Blomstedt, Commissioner of Education, members of the State Board of Education who are here with us, our wonderful staff at the Institute, Marjorie Kostelnik, my partner in co-chairing this, and really all of you and the early childhood workforce. We are dedicated to doing this right. And today is one of many steps. This isn't the first step. You got us here. Now let's work together to go further. I have a wonderful panel of commission members. And let me tell you that the commission members, their signatures, as it were, are all over this report. If, as an academic, I were to write this report, would have written this report, starting 3 years ago, it never would have looked like it looks today. It's much better because of their participation and the participation of the other commission members who you saw standing earlier. So their names are in the program. I'm gonna introduce each briefly as I ask them a question. I'm gonna kind of try to be sort of like Judy Woodruff, if you watch that show, Anderson Cooper. I'm not sure I'm into the Fox thing, you know? And I don't think we have anybody here who says no, who says, early childhood, no, you know, so we're all, you know, very, very strongly supportive. But we have different opinions, and so I'm not going to go in any kind of alphabetical order or anything else, but just the way I'd like to raise some questions here. And I've invited them to add to each other's points of view and to object if that seems right, and we're all friends, and we're used to objecting. Kathy Lang, you are the state director of the Nebraska Business Development Center at the University of Nebraska at Omaha, and formerly served as the director of the Nebraska Department of Economic Development and the Nebraska Commissioner of Labor. You are also the Nebraska Property Tax Administrator. We won't talk about that too much. And the Deputy Tax Commissioner. Why did you agree to serve on this commission? And what did you think you could contribute to it?
You asked me.
I did.
I, based on our conversation, saw this as vital for Nebraska's future. But my passion and interest is because of my past. I was a working parent, and we relied so much on our children's care provider, people like Mariah. And how hard our child care provider worked to provide care to our children, and how important it was for us to have in-home care. I was a very strong advocate of in-home care. And from my workforce and education perspective, how important it is to assure that we support high quality care, which, as has been said, all of this work is based on science, and that is foundational to this report. And then from the business and economic perspective, it really is about the big picture. All child care is a business, and every single day, people across our state are opening the doors in their homes and in their centers, and it's a business. And the Nebraska Business Development Center is here to support them. Parents are seeking care. And the child care talent because it is a talent, and within the talent is workforce and business owners. We want to see that there is proper compensation for the very important work that we do, and that's what brought me to this commission.
Thank you. So, I don't have enough time for applause. They all deserve applause. Well, later, okay? I'll tell you when, all right. Mariah Stowe, you operate a private family childcare home in Lincoln, serving 12 children. Your home-based childcare business serves families with children from 4 months to 4 years. Why did you join the commission? And can you help us understand who is in the early childhood workforce? Who is included in this?
So when I was first approached to join the commission, I thought it sounded really interesting. I had no idea what I was getting into. but yeah, it's been really great. I like being able to bring that side to the field of when we're sitting at the table, that I can talk directly to working with the children, and that every day that's what I do. So I can bring that to people who care about the workforce and care about the children, but haven't directly worked with them maybe that recently. When we talk about who's in the workforce, it can get, it's a very broad range. We have the family child care providers, we have assistants who work in family child care and in centers, we have centers. We have the coaches who come and work with programs to help them have higher quality, and we have home visitors who come to families. Then there's a wide range, and I think the importance of what we outline is just we want parents to have a choice and that they at least have the option for high quality care if they in whatever setting that they choose.
Thank you, Mara. Nancy Edick. You've been on the faculty of the UNO College of Education since 1993, when you were 14, I think, right? not quite. And dean of the college since 2009. You hold both a Bachelor of Science in Elementary Education, you were a teacher, and a Master of Science in Supervision and Administration from UNO, and a doctoral degree in Educational Administration and Supervision from the joint program at UNO-UNL. Given your background, can you tell us why we should devote so much attention to the early childhood workforce at this time?
Yeah, thanks, Sam. And of course, the commission's been a learning journey for me, too, because I did not have the level of expertise in early childhood that Mariah does, for example. So participating in this at the higher education level, you know, we have 16 different educator preparation institutions in the state that lead to the opportunities for a bachelor's degree and beyond that. But in addition to that, we have tremendous partnerships with our community colleges. We have partnerships with NDE that provides ongoing professional development opportunities. We have a whole network of support from First Five Nebraska to Sixpence that you've heard about. So we have this whole connection of opportunities around advancing and moving forward with early childhood, high quality preparation. So it's a tremendous opportunity. And this report and this commission has helped us create a roadmap, ways to connect those things so that there are efficiencies and so there are more opportunities to really build a strong, highly qualified workforce, even though they may come at it from different angles, from different experiences, from different levels of formal preparation, but there's lots of expertise across all the spectrum. And so this helps us weave that together and move things together in the right direction on behalf of quality.
Very good, thank you. Tawana Grover, you are the superintendent of the Grand Island Public Schools, and previously you were with the DeSoto Independent School District in DeSoto, Texas. Just last year, you were named to the prestigious Broad Academy, a professional development program comprised of aspiring urban and state superintendents, as well as leaders already running high-performing public school systems. Dr. Grover, isn't Nebraska's early childhood workforce already qualified? Don't we have competencies already for our kids? What problems are we trying to solve?
Well, I think that was one of the, I guess maybe the call to action to be a part of the work of the commission. And yes, we do have very qualified, caring, individuals that are working with our students on a daily basis. I think the challenge for us is really just closing that knowing and doing gap. So we know what we need to do for our students, but when you have a mixed delivery method, there are so many different ways that our students can receive, whether it's in-home care or center-based, and depending on who you work for and where you work, those qualifications, they differ. And I think what the commission has done has really put in front of us, how do we create coherence so that every student, regardless of their zip code, regardless of where they are, every student has the opportunity to have that high quality instruction. And so the Department of Education, they adopted the competencies. So they're out there for us just even last year. And it really takes us, it just combines that the heart and warmth of relationships that we want to give to our students, but it really puts out to us what our educators, our providers, what they should know, understand, and be able to do for our most vulnerable students. And so, yes, hashtag the early years matter.
Hey, thank you. John Spotts, as the executive director of the Nebraska Association of School Boards. You've led this organization with more than 240 members since 2012. You're a Nebraskan through and through, born and raised here with a bachelor's and JD from UNL. Tell us about the cost of implementing the commission's recommendations. Can we afford this?
Yeah.
Who's gonna pay for it?
Great question, and Sam, thank you for inviting me, and I really wanna say, I appreciate being a part of something like this on behalf of school board members. I don't know if 10 years ago it would have been obvious to include school board members. And I think I represent 1,700 elected community leaders statewide. And the understanding that we have about early childhood is better today than it's ever been. And I compliment the Buffett Early Childhood Organization, the other commission members, and many of the people in this room for our understanding. And the question that I have isn't how are we going to afford it, but how can we can't afford not to do it. And my office is in South Lincoln, on just north of Highway 2 on 13th Street. And across the street from us is the state pen. And there's a big billboard right now out front of the state pen said there is a $10,000 hiring bonus for corrections workers right now. And Senator Stinner alluded to this about our overcrowding. And what I've been saying for a while now is that the main problem we have as it relates to economics and funding and property taxes is that the narrative is failing all of us. And the narrative from the state says, well, our taxes are too high because we spend too much, or we need to run government more like a business. And that narrative is failing everybody, and that's urban and rural, Republicans and Democrats, in my world, equalized and non-equalized. So when we talk about issues like property taxes, as opposed to saying, how do we lower spending, I'm gonna copy something Susan said, how do we invest in areas where there is a rate of return? And common sense will tell you this, but also the data will tell you this, that the highest rate of return for investments in governments and political subdivisions is in early childhood. So if we do run the state like a business, if that's what we're looking at it, our product is the people, and a business is gonna say, how do we prioritize in areas where there's a higher rate of return? That's early childhood. Everybody wins when we invest in early childhood, and by changing that narrative, I feel it, I see it out in the field. People are getting it more now. Changing that narrative is gonna be beneficial for all of us.
Thank you. So, you know, I've worried sometimes, recently my wife and I walked into Target, we saw this huge sign, said $13 an hour. And I want all the early childhood people not to look at the sign, right? Because I never thought we were gonna lose anybody to the state penitentiary system. I still don't. Mariah. Let's talk about the kind of qualifications that are needed to care for young children. Because, I mean, people just don't get it. Do those caring for babies need to be as skilled as or educated as those teaching older children? Is infant care more than feeding, changing, and napping? Is it just as complex as educating a third grader?
So yeah, I think when we think about infants, it can be just instinct to think, oh, well, they eat, they sleep, you know, you gotta change their diapers sometimes, and that's it. But when you look at that from being a teacher who's caring for more than one infant at a time, sometimes these people enter the workforce and they don't have any infant-specific training. And so what happens then is that they go into it and here they are caring for these babies and they don't know how to support breastfeeding or they don't know how to respect the infant's cues. We learned, like Marjorie talked about, brain development is huge. There are gaps in their brains that we know through positive relationships and interactions they will grow and build, and those first years are going to affect how they are in the later years and as they get older. So if we don't have an educated workforce caring for those children at that age, then they may not be prepared and ready for entering school in those later years. And so that's where it's just, I like how Susan worded it, it's a different skill set that you need to care for infants than the older years, but it is still just as complex and just as needed.
And just as exhausting.
It is.
Maybe
yeah.
even more so.
Yeah,
any infant caregivers here knows that. Let's
Sam,
think.
Can I add
yeah,
something
so
to
please.
That? Because the other thing that these early childhood educators do is provide parents with information
mm-hmm.
that we as parents
yes.
may not have because a book didn't come with that baby when we brought
mm-hmm.
them home. So
and
they
that's
educate.
Something that, yeah, I see. I often have parents that will come to me, you know, when a child's sick. Well, what about Pedialyte? I've heard about Pedialyte. Do you know what we should do with that? And so because they see me every day, they can come to me with those questions. And sometimes I do refer them to their pediatrician because it's just not a question I'm educated to answer. But I can refer them to. That would be a good question to ask your pediatrician. Or, yeah, in my experience, here's what happens. And then they go home and they have stronger connections with their children because they're awakened when you tell a parent of an eight-month-old that, notice how when you lean them backwards, they start to tip their head back too because they want to control it. They want to be in charge too. And you just see the parents' eyes light up that, like, my baby is doing stuff and it's not just laying there. And, you know, it gets them excited. And then they continue to build those positive interactions, not just at the program, but also at home with
you make us all want to have our kids in your program. Don't forget that Mariah has children I mentioned from 4 months to 4 years. She could have them through 6 years of age.
Up to kindergarten.
And she is up to kindergarten, and she's able to handle children in that entire age span. And that is a huge amount to know. So we talk actually about early childhood is birth through eight. That is the period of early childhood, through basically through the end of third grade. Let me turn to Tawana and say, why should public schools care about infants, toddlers, preschoolers? In Nebraska, schools are only mandated to educate children from kindergarten age up, right? Matt, isn't that correct? Something that, and all of my friends on the board who are here, we talk about that all the time.
Wow, I think it kind of goes back to when you talked about the brain development. And so those early years are so critical. We find ourselves oftentimes having to think about how do we close the achievement gap? You know, how do we help support the mental health issues or just the social emotional learning? And many of those skills they're able to learn through early childhood education. And, you know, often people, they want us to think about our graduates. So I just want to get to the other end, you know, of the spectrum. So we are expected to graduate students who can help create jobs, who can attract jobs, who can fill jobs. And I think that we cannot ignore the foundational facts that when we look at the students who graduate from high school, the students who are more likely to go on to college, the higher earning, it all starts back at early childhood education. And that has to be part of the conversation. that we cannot expect for students to enter high school without a solid early childhood education. That's why, for us, it's the number one goal of our strategic plan is early childhood education. That's how we get to students who thrive.
Thank you. Both John and Nancy, I'll bet, have a lot to say about this, because you both are looking at this entire continuum, not just at the early childhood years, but across those years. So do you want to respond to Tawana on that?
Yeah, well, and I think we have a real opportunity, because just as Marjorie said, we've discovered so much about the importance of early development in the last decade. And we also have a new generation that is coming into the workforce that has that context to work from. So they're excited and they value this idea of working with young children. So we have the interest that's there, but we have to make sure that if this is the field they choose to go into, that they have appropriate compensation to be able to choose a field that they're very interested in. Right now, our early childhood program is the fastest growing program in teacher education.
So how does that happen? How does that happen if they know how much their salary will likely be after they leave?
I'm not sure they know. I mean, seriously, because they know how important
now
it
they
is.
Know.
Yeah, and that's an important part of the commission's work. They know and understand and they embrace how important the work is. And they're willing to take on this journey. Young people are, I mean, they're idealistic and they believe in the future. And they're willing to invest in that. But boy, we've got to meet them partway. And we have to do something about the compensation. And the vast difference between the public school systems and the centers, which Susan pointed out, double. It's a 100% difference in the salary. That's just wrong. And especially when we have center leaders like Mariah that deserve that level of compensation. And she's taking an interesting journey to her credentialing as a bachelor's degree too, which I think points to another important piece about making sure we offer alternative pathways for those young people who have this ambition and this desire to get there.
So it's interesting that you say you're not sure that they know, but that's every single one of us, and I include myself because I started off as a preschool, kindergarten, first grade teacher too. Every single one of us started off not looking at how much money we're gonna make, but looking at those children's faces. That's what drew us, that's what kept us, that's what keeps us still now. John?
Yeah, and I would, and regarding the school's involvement in this, every fall we travel around the state at our area membership meetings where we meet with school board members and superintendents, and every year we ask them a question, try to get feedback and data. And a lot of times it deals with, well, how do you cut spending and how do you, you know, manage your budgets and things. This year we threw a loop, we kind of threw a wrench at them. We said, if you had funding available, what would you use it on? And the number one issue, not surprisingly, was facilities, and that's gonna be there for a while. The number two area was early childhood. Over 30% of the school board members and superintendents around the state have recognized the importance of early childhood.
Has that changed in recent years?
I think so. And I think 5 years ago it wouldn't have registered. I think it's a credit to you and the people in this room of communicating the importance of it, understanding the brain science behind all of that. So one of the things we ask school board members say is, what does a healthy, successful graduate from your district look like? Once you see that and work backward and say, what are the barriers to getting there? And then what are the things that are gonna help propel people to get there? What's a bigger issue, barrier, if you don't have high quality, accessible early childhood in your community? And so traditionally we said to school boards, there's three things you have to do. You gotta do budget, you gotta do policy, and you gotta hire, fire, and evaluate the superintendent. We're saying there really needs to be a fourth area, and that is that role of a community leader. And if you identify as a district, just like in Grand Island, as a strategic plan saying early childhood is important, how do you engage the business community? How do you engage the early childhood professionals around this issue? And I'm really excited to see how the schools can engage in this more directly.
Let me turn to Kathy, especially in regard to that community engagement and the relationship. What do we know about the relationship between availability of childcare and economic vitality in small communities, and actually in any community in this state and other states?
We know a lot about it, and I want to give a shout out. Casey Baylitz is here today, and Casey wrote an article that appeared in the Columbus paper yesterday. And what Casey addressed in his article goes to this question. It is correct that numbers of years ago, if you talked about economic development, you were isolated within a conversation about business, business development, business attraction. If you were engaged in a conversation about community development, Casey referred to them as the touchy-feely side of development, but you were engaged in what's going on in your community, how do you make your community great, and sort of in the middle of all this was workforce. Workforce existed as an issue for a very long time, but as it sort of, as it coalesced as one of the most important issues that we're facing, workforce development, the three began to triangulate. And as we are fond to say at the Nebraska Business Development Center, supporting the development of wonderful small businesses across our state, they cannot be successful if we don't have strong, vibrant communities. And strong, vibrant communities cannot exist if it doesn't have high quality childcare. Senator Stinner told us a story before coming in here that as he would interview young people for his bank, they wanted to know first and foremost, what's my job, what's my salary? Then they wanted to know what's going on in this community, why do I want to be here? And then their next question was, is there quality childcare in this community? So it is vitally important to the future economic success of our state. Being the best place to be a child is going to be vitally important for Nebraska.
And this is something that is very, very important in this group. We have people who have started high quality childcare from the ground up, as in Red Cloud. And we have the Nebraska Children and Family Foundation that's working with maybe two dozen communities by now on trying to help them to find ways to provide exactly what Kathy has just described. And we have many more stories. These are stories that we want to collect over the coming years, and we want people to know about it because we can all learn so much from it. But wait, I'm being Judy Woodruff here, although not nearly as pretty as the, and I have breaking news. Although it'd be in my ear, right? She wouldn't know. Hey, everybody. We're trending in Nebraska. Hashtag early years matter. It's working. Keep tweeting. All right? Never say I didn't say tweet. All right. We're sort of talking about business. So let me turn back to Mariah and ask Mariah. You're a professional businesswoman and an early childhood educator with specialized skills and knowledge. Help us understand what in-home childcare providers need to know in order to run a successful childcare business. I believe that in-home childcare gets a bad rap, and they need to hear something from you about what you're really doing.
Yeah, so I think we often get overlooked as being a business, that, you know, it's fairly easy to just apply for a license and suddenly you're a business. And there's not like a training or anything beforehand. We aren't referred to the Business Development Center often to have anybody that talks to us about the business side of things. I was lucky enough to be working on my associate's degree, and I was able to take an administration class through the SEC program here in Lincoln that helped me prepare for staffing. And, you know, you have to be able to have students, so you need to be able to talk with families, you need to be able to get word out there, but you also have to know record keeping, and you have to have all of that knowledge in addition to caring for children. But while caring for children is important, you also need to know how to run a successful business, otherwise you're not going to be able to care for the children. When you look at just the complexity of owning a business, there's a whole range of skills that just can sometimes, I think, be overlooked, unfortunately, in family childcare, just because there's not a lot of trainings out there that are offered for it, and they're not always required as early as maybe they should be, so that these people can have the chance to run a successful business and be given opportunities so that they're not set up to fail.
Great. So, and one of the concerns that we on the commission have had is that a report of the kind that we are sharing here, and we're going to share nationally. Monday, I was in New York City talking to 100 people there about what we're doing here, and they were pretty amazed because no other state in the nation has a proposal as comprehensive as we do here. But some people may start to think, well, they may be put out of business because of the kinds of recommendations that are here. So, John, let me ask you to think a little out loud. Will private home child care and for-profit centers go out of business because of the commission's goals? Does this report recommend free pre-K for all?
No, honestly, I think what's going to happen here is the more people understand the value of high-quality early childhood, as people begin to understand the importance of that brain science and brain development earlier on, I think what we're going to see is increased demand. And as that demand increases, we need a plan to meet that demand all across the state of Nebraska, in urban and rural places all across the state of Nebraska. So I agree with what you said. This is exciting to have a comprehensive plan like this, because oftentimes when we're trying to solve problems in the state of Nebraska, there's a lot of good things going on all over the places, and that's true in early childhood, but to have a vision that we can all point to really is exciting. And I think as the demand will increase, which I think it will, there's got to be a plan for meeting that. So this gives us a chance to do that.
Well, and I think an important point about the report is choice is throughout the report. And choice is so important when it comes to early care. The quote about the provider who tends to know about pregnancies before other members of the family points to that. You really are a part of the family. And so for those people who want in-home care, that is a partnership in almost being a part of the family of raising the child, we don't ever want to take that choice away, and the report makes that clear. What we want to do is provide lots of opportunities for quality enhancements and financial incentives to be able to maintain that in-home care. We have tremendous diversity throughout the state of Nebraska. We know that over 30% of young children are children of color. We need to make sure that we're accommodating that diverse population. And by offering choice, viable, high-quality choice, we can help address that issue around the diversity of the workforce.
Looking out into the audience here, I see a couple of people, and I'm sure I'm missing some because I have a lot of lights in my eyes, who are school superintendents. Mark Adler, I know, is here from Ralston. And I think Cheryl Logan from OPS is here. There are probably other superintendents, too. Tawana, can you talk to your colleagues a little bit about this? After all, we know that, like as in many other states, the education system in Nebraska is already under financial stress. Can we afford to expand childcare before we fix or take care of all the other K-12 issues that we face? How can we make room for more investment?
I mean, I think it goes back to the earlier quote that we can't afford not to invest. As we talked about, the earlier years are so important to the work that we do. And so I don't think we as superintendents want to be put in a position to choose. Are you asking me to choose between college readiness and choose between early childhood education? We're saying that they're both fundamentally important to the work that we do. And the commission, the work there, it has inspired such a spirit of collaboration among our communities. And I think when we get people in the room and just having that greater appreciation to how we work with our community partners and utilizing this report to see how can we leverage our resources, how can we coordinate our efforts so that together that we can reach all students, all children, all babies.
Kathy, can you add to that because of the perspective you have on communities that surround these schools?
As I came on this commission and being a strong advocate for in-home care,
I wouldn't have stayed on the commission if I thought that we were moving in a direction of somehow eliminating such a vital opportunity in our state. I have been very, very proud to observe, as all of us have worked together on this, the recognition of how important it is that the parent, the family with their child, gets to choose where their child is in these early years, gets to choose the environment where they are. The other thing, and it's been said again, but I think it bears repeating, as we move to action, how do we make sure that those individuals, those small business owners who are starting at about probably 6 o'clock in the morning until about maybe even 7 o'clock at night, caring for children in their home, also have access to the training and education opportunities that maybe their peers in a center can more easily access. So we've got to think about the delivering these education opportunities so that all providers have that opportunity to be exposed to understanding the science and the knowledge and the development of a child along the way.
Nancy, can you add to that as a dean of a college of education?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of opportunities for additional partnerships to address those kinds of things. And again, some of the suggestions and the recommendation in the report talk to those opportunities, creating partnerships and pathways between the different entities.
Right, and using what we have already and trying to link them together instead of building something new.
Absolutely.
Okay, so one of the big questions that I expect people to ask is, how are you going to pay for this? I mean, that's a lot of money, right? Although, as Susan pointed out, it is three quarters for full funding, and full funding isn't just better pay. Full funding is the entire shooting match. It's facilities, it's preparation, it certainly is also wages and many other parts of this. It's that costs three quarters of 1% of the gross domestic product of the state of Nebraska. Now, needless to say, the gross domestic product of the state of Nebraska is not in a bank account anywhere where we can withdraw that much money. But it also is clear that we're not looking to Governor Ricketts and his successors to pay that bill alone. So, John, you've done a lot of thinking about cost and in schools and also in early childhood. Talk about that. How do you answer the person who says we can't afford this?
Yeah, great question. I think we've been guilty for a long time. When there's an issue, we go to the legislature. Well, how do you fix this? And I certainly wouldn't say the legislature or the state government isn't a part of the solution, but the solution's in this room. The solution's going to be those communities coming together around a vision for what that community is going to look like over the next 20 years, and we have to be proactive. We've got to engage the business community a little bit differently, and go back to what I talked about earlier, that narrative of saying, if you're a taxpayer in the state of Nebraska, if you're a taxpayer in a local community, where do you want money to be invested? Where's the highest rate of return for that investment? And how do you collaborate collectively in a community to do that? Now, again, Senator Stinner and the folks at the legislature will be a part of this, hopefully, to some degree. But the solution is in this room. The solution is in your communities.
Let me throw this out to any of you here, and that is, if these recommendations are implemented, let's look ahead. We have a long horizon. We're saying over the next 10 years, these are the things that we want to do. You know, I came here saying we're going to make Nebraska the best place in the nation to be a baby. Well, it takes a little while, and we've only just got started, and we're working with all of you who've been doing that for a long time already. What will change? How will things look different in 10 years? Anybody?
So as I thought about this report, it is big, it is audacious, it is visionary, and it sets a guiding light 10 years out. And here we are today, and I think about what we have in our child care provider environment, all the different kinds of care, what we have going on in the K-12 system, and then the continuing developed science to help guide us and keep us honest about why we're doing all this. And it feels like a great big triangle to me. So we have so much diversity and opportunity and ideas and people here, and we're driving to this particular point 10 years out. Everything will happen with a step. And to the point John just said, it's going to happen in a community and it's going to happen with people. And so what's so exciting is what happens after the launch, and I love that word launch, it's not a report on a shelf, and how do we take that and really understand it and then begin to take steps one at a time towards that point in the future. And the science guiding us all the way along.
Right. And Sam, if you'll let me, if you've heard me talk over the last few years, I use a 20-year chart. So I might step out to 20 years.
We're compressing that. 10 years.
Well, the last several years, we do the 20-year chart in Nebraska. And we look at, as a percentage of the state budget, what are the items that are growing as a percentage? And the chart that we use shows corrections going up, Medicaid going up, juvenile justice going up. What's going down as a percentage? Higher ed and K-12. So purely from a business model, you see your expenses going up and your investments going down year after year. That's not sustainable. So these community-based solutions, I would anticipate that leveling out. And at some point, what if 20 years from now, as a percentage of the state budget, the things increasing were the investments. The things increasing were K-12, or higher education, early childhood. And the things we don't want to spend money on, the expenses, are going down as a percentage of the state budget. I've said for a while, how do we make people ineligible for corrections and Medicaid, meaning they're not committing crimes and they have a job with health insurance? That should be the goal.
Yeah. As a higher education representative here, one of the things I think about is providing opportunities and pathways for more people that are in this early childhood space to receive degrees, bachelor's degrees, advanced degrees, because the reality is compensation is tied to qualifications all the way across the board. So having opportunities for more early childhood providers to advance in their credentials that warrant the salaries that are deserved. That happens through scholarship opportunities. It happens through articulation agreements between different entities that create seamless pathways to achieving those goals. It's adding prestige and uplifting the profession. All of those things merge together. So from a higher ed perspective, I hope to see better pathways, better compensation, more incentives, so that those people that are interested know they're going into a well-paid profession.
Tawana, do you see a role for the highly experienced early childhood professional who doesn't have a degree? I don't disagree with Nancy, but I want to broaden it. Are we able to articulate and define competencies and then find a way of evaluating them so that those people who are really excellent and are not degreed and maybe can't find the time or the money or even the interest in getting a degree still can have a major role here? Is that possible?
The short answer is absolutely. Because if you think about the competencies, right, we're saying what you know, what you understand, what you're able to do, the knowledge and skills. How are you interacting with students, with children on a daily basis? And so we're able to observe that by going out into the centers. And I think that by the number of people that are in this room today and the hundreds of people that are watching online and this very comprehensive report that we have, it shows us what our current state is right now, and it gives us that vision to how, we will look in the future. I have to believe that we have an opportunity to preserve our communities as well as grow our state, and it's going to take all of us, and we cannot discount. And I think, for me, that's been one of the most eye-opening parts of this process, is that we are not isolated from our home care providers, from our center providers. We have to lock arms And there are enough people in this room that can think of beyond a degree, right? We can think beyond that to our service delivery model of how we are guaranteeing that, yes, Nebraska is the best place to be a baby.
Thank you. Let me just, we're going to have a few minutes to do something that my staff will wonder why I'm doing, which is inviting all of you to ask a couple questions, because we have a few more minutes, and we didn't prepare that, but that's going to be fine, because I know you'll play along. But let me just ask one more question to the panel as a whole, and that is, how has being a member of the commission changed how you think about the early childhood workforce? Let's start with you, Mariah.
I think for me as an educator, being on the commission showed me that my voice mattered, that, you know, people were listening, and that when you can come to the table and bring these issues up, that, you know, there are people that do care. It's not, I think sometimes there's like an us versus them mentality, and it was not that at all. From the commission and going on through the commission to other organizations, I have always been met with very welcome arms, and people want to hear the voice of those working in the field. And so that was one of the big things, that with the commission, I felt that my voice was heard and that it mattered, that what the people who were in the trenches were doing.
Kathy is more of a consumer than a professional in this field. How has this changed your view of the workforce?
So in part, it confirmed my view of how I felt about early childhood care and education and quality. But what it also did is it has allowed me to strengthen my voice in this regard, particularly to the clients that we serve at the Nebraska Business Development Center, about how important it is to support the development of childcare, high quality childcare. So our consultants across Nebraska who work with business owners to start and grow their childcare business are armed with information about quality. And that had never happened before because it wasn't available. And so this changes for us how we talk with our clients who are starting and growing childcare business across Nebraska.
And John, as a person who interacts with thousands of elected school board members, now that's a tough one. How has this affected you?
Well, I want to echo something Kathy said, and I kind of came to this also as a consumer. My youngest child just turned 5 and started kindergarten this year. And so at one point, I had 3 kids in daycare, and I knew the expense, but I also knew that they weren't getting rich off of this. And throughout all of that time, I was always worried we were going to lose the preschool teacher or the daycare providers that became really a big part of our lives. And excuse me. And one of the things I learned is really how passionate they are about the profession. It's not simply about the money. And I think I've learned how we, as an organization, as 1,700 elected community leaders, can better advocate for that profession.
Tawana, as a school administrator, where does this fit in your thinking as far as the early childhood workforce goes?
From the district perspective, I think it really allows us to utilize our influence, our reach out into our community to help continue to educate people on the importance of early childhood education. And through the work of the commission, I think I'll walk away just knowing that we cannot ignore the investment. The return on investment is just too high. We cannot ignore it.
And Nancy, in higher ed, where does this fit? Because you have such a wide range of responsibilities from instruction to research to community engagement.
Well, one, I think that being a part of the commission has given me a network that has helped my career tremendously, but it's been able to help me connect faculty that are in the early childhood area to other people across the state. We're in Omaha, and this has certainly given me a broader vision and a better understanding of the entire context across the state of Nebraska, and that this is something that we all need to work really hard and do it collaboratively and not competitively as we work together. So I've also had the opportunity to do a lot of hiring during my 11th year as dean. And we have made a very intentional focus on early childhood, which historically wasn't something that we had done as a college. So it's changed me and my priorities, and they've certainly become more focused on early childhood.
And let me point out that Nancy is the dean of one of the three colleges of education at the University of Nebraska, and the other deans also participated, and I think are here today, Grace Mims from UNK, Sherry Jones, who is the current dean at UNL, and Beth Dahl, who was the interim dean for several years between Marjorie and Sherry, and we're very grateful. So there's, you can look in your programs and you see the list of commissioners and the diversity that we learn from. So here's what I'd like to do, Aaron, without having given you any warning, but we're ready for it. I see my colleagues are ready for it. We have some microphones. We have a few minutes left, another 10 or so, or even a little longer. Questions from you. Right down here, can we take a question from our state board member, Lisa? There
you go. This is all amazing. When you mentioned that it's a small business, the federal government used to give small business money, you know, startup. Is that available for this type of situation, small business?
There are many services that are provided to help individuals start and grow small business. Nebraska Business Development Center is only one. The resources available to directly assist with that are probably more in the area of loans, like the Small Business Administration. And so there are opportunities to be able to get those kind of resources. I would have to say right now, to my knowledge, I am not sure of any direct grants that would go to this, but my guess is within a community, there's a way to look at perhaps USDA rural development grants that could come and help support the development of high quality child care in a community. So yes, there may be some of those resources.
I walked past Representative Fortenberry's office on the way downstairs here. Maybe we ought to pay a visit on the way out. another question. I can't see very well because of the lights. Over there. And will you give us your name and where you're from?
Hi, David Rogers from Fremont, Nebraska. I want to direct a question to both John and to Tawana. I agree with you. The solution is in the community to choose the areas to invest. My question is, how do we have metrics, or Tawana talked about ROI, return on investment. How do we measure that and see what types of investments that we're doing are going to be the most effective to bring about the greatest return on investment?
Well, I think there's a number of ways to do that. There's a lot of data out there that shows for every dollar invested in early childhood, there's a higher rate of return there than anywhere else. But there's a number of things, and Senator Stinner talked about that. As a district, if you're gonna make early childhood a priority, I would anticipate your third grade reading scores are gonna go up. There's a number of metrics that we need to utilize. Because if it is important, and we believe it's important, we think the data is going to show that. So there's a number of metrics that you can use over a period of time, reading scores, test scores, parent engagement, community engagement, graduation rates, et cetera, et cetera. Also, I would believe statewide, you're going to see economic numbers get better, too. As people become more employable over a period of time, I think you're going to see a broadening of the economic base, which everybody wins under that.
Tawana?
I think John covered it.
Okay. and let me add that this is a challenge for us in the field academically as well. How to evaluate competencies? We know what they are. We know how to write them. We know how to read them. We even know how to do them. But how do we evaluate them on what kind of set of criteria? And that's still work to be done.
And let me also, it is tough, you're right. And Sam and I are in a meeting once with somebody who said, how do we see results in 2 years? And it's like, well, there may be some, but this is a long-term issue. And I think one of the problems that we have is we're very reactive as a state government. We react to the circumstances out there. what we've got to do is be more proactive. And it's not a one-year vision. It's not a two-year vision. This is a 10-year, 20-year vision that we're trying to create here. So measuring that is going to be very important.
The two-year thing just brought to mind something Kevin Riley said to me. He was formerly the, for many years, wonderful superintendent in Gretna, Nebraska. And when we started working, the Institute started working with the learning community in Douglas and Sarpy counties, he said to all the other superintendents, this is a 20-year operation. Now, I didn't promise I was going to stick around for 20 years, but it isn't a two-year operation, that's for sure. We have a question over here, I think.
It's actually a response to the question over there. My name is Cindy Rowell. I'm with the Max and Marjorie Fisher Foundation, and we're doing very similar work in Detroit, and we're just honored to be here today, Kamara and I. The fascinating report, it's really great. We're taking it back. We're going to take a look at how we can do this in our community. But the one thing that we did do and continue to update regularly is a ROI on these investments. We partnered with the Amherst Wilder Foundation in Minnesota. They've developed a formula that they can assess the ROI at a city level, at a county level, and at a state level. And they're happy to work with anyone that's interested in taking a look at that data and developing those metrics for your own community. I'd be happy to share it.
Thank you. Right down here in front.
Hello, my name is Catherine Patton, and I'm from Omaha, Nebraska, and I run two daycares academy, Revolution of Love Academy. And one of the things that I was thinking, God, I'm here today. I'm stepping out of my little box to say that the things that we do in the community, and then the fear that only myself and my workers and my parents that we have, you know, based on the school, preschool and all the things and meeting the qualifications, and also with the Buffett, you know, they fear, and you know, getting together with the other centers that's in the community and saying, what do we got to do? And as I evaluate what I'm doing with my children, that the power that each one of us have to have in order to move this thing forward. And as I feared, Buffett is coming in here, and she's doing this, and she's doing that. The school is coming here, and all the people that is working. But I'm in this community with gang members. I'm in this community with our children that are parents that's in prison. I'm dealing with the parents that's coming in that is freaked out because, you know, they don't have the ethics of working and how to build and going back to school because of all the fears. But one of the things that I have been able to do with some of the kiddos that I work with, I have developed a program about true leadership. What is a true leader? And what would you have to do at 7 years old to 13 to build this kingdom, to go stay in the community as well as go get the education, but come back and stop fearing, saying, oh, I gotta go into the urban areas, I gotta live out there, but build your community up. And how do you do this with no money, with fear? And you stand on the foundation that I'm trying to do with the kiddos, you know? And we use the, I'm kinda nervous here because I'm so passionate about what I do and what I have been trying to do. But we use the eagle, we use the lion, and we use the pigeons. And I say, okay, every day before they go to school, because I am the owner, but I'm there, I'm in the kitchen, I'm in the classroom, I'm in the office, I'm this person with this hat. But what I do with these kiddos, when I let them off to school, I say, okay, this is what you're going to have to do. You got to have the ears. You have to incline your ears to be able to hear. You got to open your eyes to have the spiritual eyes, because you got to come back to the community. You got to be that parent that you know you don't have that parent, but you got to be that person that, because maybe your mom's been drinking or dad's been drinking or you in that pain to be able to, and I know I need to get going, but I would really like to meet each one of you all so that you could see some of the things that I'm doing in the community and teaching them how to be world changers.
Thank you.
You understand?
Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. We are here to work with you and to learn from you and not to take from you, not to take away anything.
I know. Okay.
Anderson Cooper just noted that we are now number one on Twitter. Earlyyearsmatter.org. Keep tweeting. All right. In back here, yes.
Hi, I'm Corey Quimby. I own Bubbles and Blocks Child Development Center here in town. And one of my questions would be, what is the implementation look like if the funding is all there? Because right now with the child care subsidy, like we've seen, if someone isn't present, you don't get paid. Is it going to be, okay, the centers are making this much more, but they have to meet a requirement of paying their teachers this much? Like, where are those funds being allocated? Because right now, if we want to have a raise for the teachers, if we give a dollar to everyone, that money has to come from the parents. So it's money in, money out.
Well, we want that to be different. I don't want to give this lame excuse like, well, we don't know yet, we're going to work on it, we got some time. But in fact, we don't know yet, we have to work on it. It really is not an automatic type of thing. But you, as you, for example, you're talking about subsidy, talking about Title 20, we need to work, that's just as with small business, we need to work with our federal partners. We need to work with our state partners. We need to work locally. And this is setting us up to work with all of you to do that. This isn't a University of Nebraska thing. We've got this, we actually took that name off of the folder that you have here. It says Early Years Matter, because it matters to all of us. I can't promise you, I can say, I can, only I promise is we're going to work at that. Get your neighbors to sign up. All right, on the website. Over here, is there somebody over here? Is there a microphone over there? Over here? Okay.
My name is Dennis Hansen. Everybody has a different reason. I don't have a question. I have a comment, if that's okay. But everybody has a different reason for being here. Mine happens to be community development. And more specifically, a town that Sam referenced called Red Cloud. Probably most people think I'm here because Sally drugged me here, but that's not true. I'm here because of that community development. And one of the things that's when Sally gives many tours at the Valley Child Development Center and everywhere else, but one of the things she always says to people is it took a village. And I think what that means for Red Cloud is this commission report here is going to take a state. And I think the fact that we have such a diverse group here today for and all different reasons for coming, that's why this is going to work. Thank you.
Thank you, Dennis. We have time for maybe one or two more. One over here.
Hi, I'm Katie Krause. I work for Nebraska Extension, but I and my comment is as a mother. So a lot of you haven't seen me because I just got back from maternity leave. And I was blessed. I got 13 and a half weeks because it worked over the holidays and I took a lot of vacation time. But my family spends $23,000 a year for our child to be in phenomenal care in Omaha. I was on the wait list before I was pregnant, and I'm the only one of my friends that got a spot that's having babies in 2020. And I told them if I'm not pregnant by that time, I will pay the monthly rate to hold my spot of $1,100 a month, which is not the cheapest place in town for infant care.
A lot of pressure.
And we were very frustrated as I look at, I'm always fascinated by the finance part of this and how we finance it. I've been to DC as an advocate. And even for our family, there's like the child care tax fund. It's $5,000, no matter how many children you have. So I look at, you know, my family is fortunate we can afford to pay for our care. It still is a large burden, but we can make it work. But as we think about opportunities for the middle class families like ourselves and where there might be opportunities for tax incentives or other ways to at least make that burden a little tiny bit smaller.
Absolutely important. All right, I think we're going to end here. This has been, I hope it's been as much fun for you as it's been for us. Thank you very much. But so I'm going to ask my panel to leave the stage. And thank you. have one last part. We are very fortunate to have with us Matt Blomstedt, who is not only, I think, not only a great commissioner of public instruction, public education here, he's also my friend, and we have a lot of fun together. And I enjoy so much listening to him, learning from him, and you will too. You notice, though, that we had two names, because Matt felt like he wanted to have a partner, and that would be Danette Smith, wonderful, wonderful partner indeed. She's the CEO of NDHHS, and Danette is unable to be here this morning, but she is such a fabulous person that she waited for me. I was a little late. She waited for me outside here to tell me that she had an emergency in the agency that she has to deal with, and she felt very badly about not joining, but she knows Matt can handle it. We all know that, and so I'm very, very pleased to be able to introduce to you Matt Blomstedt.
First of all, it's really an honor to be here, but I gotta tell you something. I think Sam and some of his staff had been emailing me asking that I be able to present at this, and I'm such a good friend to Sam that all of his emails were going to my junk mail. And no, once we sorted that out, and I think I said, Sam, you have my cell. Just text me, man. Just text me. But anyway, really an honor to be here. It's a privilege to be the Commissioner of Education in the state of Nebraska. That's a privilege that I owe to you. I see so many friends in the audience that have been instrumental for my early childhood years as well, but also just the development. But I want to really thank the Nebraska State Board of Education, and I see Lisa right in front of me. I believe Pat Tim is in the room who participated as a member of the commission. I don't think I have others in the room, but I'm going to read all their names just in case. So Maureen Nichols, who's our president of the state board, Patsy Kojohn, who is our vice president, Robin Stevens from the western part of the state, who I know cares deeply about what happens in early childhood education, John Witzel from Omaha, Deb Neary from Omaha, and also Rachel Wise. So hopefully I have not missed anyone as I jotted down my notes. But the reality is, it's really an honor to be in front of all of you and know that there's so many other communities engaged in this conversation in such an important moment in time. And really such an important moment in time in the sense that I reflect back. I know you were talking about what could happen 10 years from now, and I reflect back on just watching this develop in Nebraska, watching early childhood develop in Nebraska. I was once the director of the Nebraska Rural Community Schools Association with a great number of leaders from those times that did not see necessarily the need for early childhood and the relationship with the public school system that we now have. That we argued about at moments in time, is this really our job, right? Is this really an important part of the responsibilities that we have? And I've seen that change to where I know we have superintendents all over the state, but even in this room, that would tell you it's among the most urgent things that we do in the state of Nebraska. And so thank you for your focus on that. Thanks for the work of everyone on the commission and everyone who's committed effort and time to make this report come forward. Because Danette Smith's not here, and she also called me this morning a bit in a panic saying, can you handle it? I've already seen my 3-minute sign. I'm pretty sure I can handle 3 minutes. So, but I will say our partnerships at a statewide level are absolutely critical to this. And as we continue to do this work, it's critical. And critical that we have the alignment with HHS and partners. But we have some amazing Department of Education staff here as well. I see Melody Hobson. I'm not going to be able to point out everyone in the room. I believe Deb Friesen was part of the commission. Amy Bunnell, I'm sorry if I'm missing. I can't see everyone. The lights are bright up here. But thank you to all of our department staff who dedicated a tremendous amount of time in thinking with all of you on the types of efforts underway. And I think that's really critical. So just thank you so much for all of our staff. Now, I have to just say a couple things. There's truly a statewide need for early childhood education and the thoughtful nature of this. I just was in D.C. last week working with a group on literacy, right, and early literacy and the importance of that particular work. And the reality is, if I wait till kindergarten to start a conversation around literacy with our families all across the state, we've missed something. Our best opportunities are our connections with parents and families and children at the earliest years that we can muster it. I know our future has to be in the thoughtful nature of how we build those relationships, and that's what we're doing in Nebraska. I'm terribly pleased just to be in a position where we can have this conversation and say it's time that we get to work on the workforce around early childhood. Thank you to the providers in the room as well, because yet another thing, this challenge, and I remember way back when, how are we gonna make this all work together as communities, and how are we gonna come up with solutions that are gonna work for everyone and not drive people out of this? There is so much demand today that we need all of you, and we need to find ways that we serve you well and find funding mechanisms that work for families and for businesses and for others that come together. That is where we're at. That's the call to action in this particular work. So I know that statewide need is there. But it also has to be a focus on quality, right? And we've had step up to quality in our system, but figuring out what quality is actually the investment back into the workforce. I mean, the quality comes from the workforce. The quality comes from the supports that we drive in that system. When we start talking about what competencies are necessary, it's how we train people, but it's also how we bring people along that are already in the field. How do we do that work? And that's a policy challenge for us yet, right? But that's one that's called out specifically in this report. I want to say this is doable. I mean, there are times where I think, oh my goodness, how are we going to get this all done? And there's a lot of those subjects that come together. What's fascinating to me is the leveraged capacity of the state of Nebraska, all of you in community, every parent, every family, everyone together doing this heavy lifting can actually get this done. It is clearly doable. Our conversations that we have today about what matters, and even the data conversation. So I sit here, and I just happened to, when I sat down, and you know, Susan Fritz was sitting, I just met with Susan yesterday about the importance of building a data system pre-K to workforce, to think about how that data comes together so we can invest in the proper things that we know make a difference. And so that's our work ahead with us as well. It's doable. It's doable because we've all created a level of focus that this truly matters in our education system. Now I'm gonna just kind of be able to finish on this basic point. I'm a dad of 5 kids, 4 girls and 1 boy in that order, and no, we didn't keep trying until we got the boy. That's just how it worked out. The reality is, my oldest is now a senior in high school, my youngest is 9, almost 10 years old. When I started this job as Commissioner of Education, my oldest was in 6th grade. I've been Commissioner of Education half of her school career. My other children will blame me even more if we don't get these things right. Here's my other thing. So I'm at that turning point soon. Someday I'll be a grandfather, right? If God wills it, I'll be in that position. I'll be in the position where I'm looking at a state of Nebraska that has a changing need. We have a changing need in this state from a workforce standpoint, but also just from our demographics have shifted dramatically. It is time we take care of those that need our help most, those families that are coming to our country, those families that are already in our state. Nebraska must lead the way in developing a system that addresses the challenges that we have as a country and as a nation. Nebraska will lead the nation in this area if we do this work right. That's where I see us in 10 years. Let others keep up with us. Let's do that work. Let's do it well. Thank you for all that you've done as a commission. Thank you for Sam, what you've done in your leadership. Thanks to all of the leaders in the room. I appreciate being just a small part of it. It's always better to come in at the end of a meeting. But just thank you, and give yourselves all a round of applause.
We're all full of thanks, and I am too. I just want to thank everyone here, our early care and education workforce members, commission members, speakers, everyone. Matt, thank you very much for being here. Before we end today, I just have a couple of things that to answer the question, what can you do? So first of all, please go to earlyyearsmatter.org/workforce and take a look at, for those of you who don't have a copy of the report, take a look at the report. If you want a more copies, they're more on tables. For those of you who are watching this by streaming or other electronic means, give us a call, look on our website, whatever you want. There are all kinds of ways we can get you copies of this electronically or in print. We still do print. Another thing, continue the conversation online with the hashtag Early Years Matter. Clearly, they matter, and clearly we are ahead of the football team for a few hours. And around here, you know, that's something. It doesn't even matter if it is January. Take one of these gorgeous postcards, all right? And it says thank you. And send it to someone in the field or someone who supports the field or to parents in your programs. We have a lot of these postcards. Happy to give you more and more and more. And it's a way to say thank you for being with us, and we're going to come back and even ask for more, not more money, just more support, more thinking, and to be part of what we're doing. Something important has begun. Thank you for being a part of it today. Enjoy the rest of your day. Goodbye. All of this is within our reach.